Good morning. This is a happy occasion. Grand openings, I think, are happy because a new structure like this embodies progress and a sense of growth and hope. But this isn't like any other grand opening. It's not a maintenance facility or an office building. This is a place where people who need vital care can get it at the time that they need it most. And who could describe, I think, this clinic and its potential to change lives better than Gwendolyn Christensen, who's a peer counselor with Recovery Innovations and serves at the sister facility at Fife. She delivered these remarks at the groundbreaking ceremony for this facility in November 2019, and I quote her, "I know there is hope because I'm living proof. When I see the spark of hope in the eyes of those we serve and see the success stories of those who come broken and hopeless." Each year, 2,000 Gwendolyns are going to come through the Sally Port, brought here by law enforcement and by EMS and by their own families, diverted from going to jail, from being stuck in a gurney in an emergency room waiting for treatment. Oh, I forgot, I can take this off. Thank you. That's so much better. So much better. So used to having this. Or maybe not getting treatment at all. But the Crisis Recovery Center, the CRC, will provide the door through which the 2,000 people can get properly diagnosed, can get a treatment plan, can then get the care they need that they've lacked up to that point. It was a rewarding responsibility to lead the team to get us to this point. And I want to recognize a few key players on that team over the course of this last, 3 years or whatever it's been, this odyssey. First, I want to recognize the Pierce County facilities and especially Dean Paxson, who's here. I also want to recognize our design team, BCRA, with special mention of Kent McLaren and Don Malott, our contractor, Lincoln. I think Jeff Teagues is here. Recovery Innovations, of course, which helped with the design and will operate and run this facility, has been such a key player in helping us get to this stage. The County Council, which approved the funding for this, and also Elevate Health, which was a great partner in helping us to fund this facility. By the way, I just have to mention this. I was talking to one of our speakers, David Covington, the CEO of Recovery Innovations, and he mentioned that they've got a number of these facilities, but Parkland now is the model for all future facilities. Now he can't, I've said it, so now he can't take it back. But that's exciting because I think you can just sense the light, the sort of living room feel that is intended by this particular design. If you or a loved one was in a mental health care or a substance use disorder crisis, this is the kind of facility you'd want to come and get cared for, not like others that I've had a chance to see. So next we will hear from our executive, Bruce Danmeyer, who made the establishment of this CRC priority back in 2017. Bruce.
Thank you very much, Steve. Thank you for your leadership on this. This is a great day for Pierce County because this place is about people in our community who are in crisis are going to have an option to get the care they need to start healing. You know, we all know that Washington State has not had enough behavioral health resources for a long time. I'm proud of the fact that since I've been in office, we've been prioritizing that. And we've made some good progress on that. We've got our mobile community intervention response teams. We've partnered to bring on the Cohen Veterans Clinic. I'm excited about that. We've got co-responders out supporting our law enforcement throughout the county. And I'm glad that we were part of the new behavioral health hospital, WellFound, opening up. But we still need more support for people. And this is a great example of that. So this is a great day. People who are experiencing a mental health crisis are a danger in many cases to themselves and to others. We get calls. Our uniformed first responders get a lot of calls from families that are desperate. They need help and they don't know what to do. And too many times that meant they would go to their loved one would go to a jail or to an emergency department. Both great places, but not for that person who needs care. And this facility is designed to be able to have them bring them here and quickly as we can, get those people into the care that they need so they can start becoming healthy. So that is why this is such a, I'm excited. This is such a great day for that. And when we started this in 2017 and we broke ground in 2019, we had no idea that we were going to enter into a pandemic that would make behavioral health issues kind of universal, probably for all of us, and make crisis much more prevalent. So we're opening this at a time when our community needs it the most. And that is why it is a great day in Pierce County. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Marty Campbell, Pierce County Council District Number 5. So I brought some talking points after what Bruce spoke to, got a few of them here, because it really talks about, as I cross off some of these talking points, it's because this is what Pierce County needs. And you see the executive and the council on the same page. Because when it comes to mental health, we as a county need to lead from the same page. We need to be with our sheriff on the same page. And so with that, I'm so happy to be here today to be cutting this ribbon so that we're moving forward in so many different directions, but mostly in the area of mental health crisis recovery. I want to welcome everyone to the beautiful 5th District right here in the heart of Pierce County. Where we're right in the center where it's really going to help everyone. While we're welcoming a couple other people, I want to acknowledge my colleague Jenny Hitchin from the 6th County Council District, which is just a few hundred yards that way. And so we're going to see. And is that behind the mask there? Is that Lance Goodpaster with the Franklin Pierce School District? Thank you so much, because when we came to do this, we needed outreach to the community. And Franklin Pierce led the way in hosting conversations, bringing people together and saying, this is how this is going to help us. This is how we're going to lead here in the heart of our community. And this is what it's not going to be. A lot of times it's dispelling what it's not going to be. And that's just as important getting out there. So a big thank you to you and Franklin Pierce and engaging and seeing what this is possible of being. As it was said earlier, Pierce County Council, even before myself or Councilmember Hitchin was here, stepped up and put the funding forward to this because we knew it was important. But we're not going to stop there. Just last December, we passed our mental health sales tax and chemical dependency sales tax, 0.1% that we'll start collecting in July. And by the end of the year, we're going to have new programs coming online that this will play a key part in giving people a place to come in, while they're here, getting them assessed and getting them plugged into the services they need. And so this isn't a one and done, hey, let's cut a ribbon and we solve the problem. This is but step one of many steps that we are already stepping up in funding. And so as I welcome you again to the heart, we realize today we're celebrating also the heart of our community and the mental part of our community. And we know going forward, we're gonna be leading with compassion, and this is gonna be a big part of it. Thank you everyone for being here today.
Thank you so much, Steve. So appreciate the Pierce County leadership and our council members and our law enforcement partners. I'm 54 years of age. And the year I was born, if you had the worst day of your life or of the year because you were in a car accident or you were having chest pains, It was not clear how you were going to get help. You'd have to go to the phone book and grapple through a number of different law enforcement and emergency medical response numbers to try to figure that out. If you could get to a hospital emergency department, you're going to have to ring a doorbell, and they're going to come and ask, you know, if your doctor's on panel there. It was a far different world on our worst day. Today, we have an amazing medical response system, that there are people to call, 911, poison control, others who are immediately available. And even though that worst day, it starts to get incrementally better with support, care, standardized interventions. If you need someone to come to you, EMS is on the scene with an ambulance, et cetera, and triage and treatment occurs. And if you need someplace to go, there are the resources for that. But in 2021, if your worst day is a psychiatric crisis, substance use disorder, feeling suicidal, it's like 1967 in much of the country. We're not sure who to call. The response to us is typically forged not on mental health leaders, but on our law enforcement partners, who then don't have options for where individuals might go if they need support. So 5 years ago, the National Action Alliance for Suicide Prevention, a public-private partnership responsible for the execution of the National Suicide Prevention Strategy, working in partnership with the Surgeon General and others, developed the Crisis Now model. And what we said was, looking at proof of concepts in several states, we need a single number that individuals can call. Ultimately, 988 came to the fore. A single number that a little more than a year from now, in July of 2022, will be live across the country. But those crisis call hubs will then have the ability to dispatch mobile crisis teams that go out to the individual, to the home, to the apartment, to the street. And ultimately, for those who have someplace that they need to go for immediate engagement and treatment and support, they have a facility like this that's immediately accessible. Now, when I first moved to Arizona about a decade ago, I thought that was a notion, a pie in the sky, until I did an undercover boss thing and saw it firsthand. I was in jeans and a t-shirt in a patrol car. We interacted with 17 people in crisis over the course of a night, and I saw people immediately get to the care that they needed in the same way that we do for thousands of people in the medical system every day. So we're so proud to be the operator here, working with the vision that the county has put forward. This facility, we have, by the end of Tom of 2022, as we lift up the programs that are already in place, we'll have about 25 of these facilities around, not only around the country in 10 states, but around the world. We have a facility in Adelaide, Australia, that we're in partnership with an organization called NEMI. This facility, the thought and care, the accessibility to our partners, right off the freeway, easily accessible. But then once you get here, the care that this facility articulates right from the get-go, in the open, welcoming environment, and the people, the peers who will be here to support. We're so proud to be the partners on this and really looking forward as Washington State and Pierce County continue to build out this vision.
Well, my name is Dan Olson. I'm the fire chief for Central Pierce Fire and Rescue, and this facility is within our jurisdiction. And in fact, in 2017, I wrote a letter to Executive Dan Meyer asking him to place this facility in a location, which this is right center of that location. So thank you for listening, Executive Dan Meyer. We were so pleased when we heard the final decision, because you know, we respond, and historically fire departments have responded to a lot of different types of emergencies, and our mission continues to expand, and that includes the very types of issues and challenges that our community faces when they reach this type of crisis. This facility to me really reflects, number one, a government that says we need to adapt to the needs of our citizens, and we need to put leadership, focus, emphasis. We need to talk about it, and we need to put resources into play to help our citizens. So for me, it really reflects that concept that we are here for our citizens, and they trust us to do this very work. And so today, I think that this facility reflects that, and I thank the executive and the council for providing that kind of leadership. This building didn't go up because someone had an idea. It started there. It went up because decisions were made, actions were taken, prioritization happened because of a real community problem. This is important to Central Pierce because we do end up quite often on these kinds of emergencies. We had the choice of basically taking them to the emergency room or taking them to Fife, which was more rare. And we know that when we're called and we transport them to an emergency room, which is a great facility, but is this going to solve this person's problem? Is this going to give them the opportunity to solve their problem? Secondly, having those areas out of our area, it really took our response times and begins to hinder them because we're taking a transport medic unit, one of our most critical assets, and we have to go down to Fife to transport. Well, that asset is no longer available for other time life critical emergencies. So from a community-based perspective, it's huge in addressing a real issue, but it's also from a response time perspective for if you're having a heart attack or other types of a medical emergency. Lastly, I would just represent this as at a critical time that this facility, more importantly, represents hope. And hope's an important thing. If you think about hope, if you don't have hope, where does that take you? And this facility begins that another step, I would say, of that process of bringing hope to people that have had great challenges. And it's hope for them as individuals, because we know what happens if we don't have opportunities for them. We respond on them. Law enforcement responds on them. But this provides an opportunity, which is hope, an opportunity for a change, for their families. We interact with the families who are challenged that don't know what to do. Again, it brings them hope. And then lastly, you know, as a community, I think it brings forward hope from the perspective that there's issues and they're heart-related issues. These are real impacting things to real people, and our government listens to us. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Ed Troyer. I'm your newly elected sheriff of Pierce County. I was our media person for 20 years, so I've pretty much met everybody in this room. First, I'd like to thank our retired sheriff Paul Pastor that's here for starting the ball rolling on this project. One of the things that we've learned is we cannot arrest our way out of mental health and drug problems. It didn't work. We tried it for many years. That's not gonna work. So working with these other agencies and county leaders to build these type of facilities lets us do police work, which people join the sheriffs and police department to do. Recently discovered by going through mental health calls that sometimes on a Friday or Saturday or Sunday, we'll respond to more mental health calls and people in crisis than we do burglaries, thefts, and car thefts. Their numbers are so high, and there aren't a lot of resources for people like this, and now there are. And I think the best thing that I'm seeing is that how well we work together. Bruce and I talk every other day, we meet once a week. And I wasn't here when this started, but I want everybody to know the more we can do when it comes to co-responder programs, the more we can do to intervene in mental health crisis, the safer our community be, the safer my officers be, and the safer the people that are in those crises will be. So thank gosh for this facility and all of you to make it happen. We appreciate it from law enforcement, and you'll always have our support. We're not big on defunding the police, but we are really big on supplementing the police with these type of supplementing the police with these type of facilities. So thank you.
Guys, come on up.
Perfect. There you go.
Okay. we doing?
Cutters?
Sure. Big. Yeah. We're not cutting until we're given specific instructions from Kyle. How are we looking, Kyle?
Good. Is the fellow in Miami over there?
Yes, we'll try the space here so you can get the shot.
All right. Ready?
Here we are.
Ready?
Okay, three, two, one.